Your unfailing love, O Lord, is as vast as the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches beyond the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, your justice like the ocean depths. All humanity finds shelter in the shadow of your wings. For you, Father, are the fountain of life, the light by which we see. Let us stand now and worship our perfect Father, our God. Let us pray. Almighty Father, giver of life, protector from the world, fortress against evil, light in the darkness, we raise our joyous praise to you. Today we say Alleluia in gratitude for your gift of fathers. You designed them to be a protector and guide for their children, the strength of the family in times of trouble, a loving embrace for the wounded and abandoned in our communities. We are overwhelmed that you loved us enough to make sure we had earthly fathers to remind us of your love for us. And when our biological fathers were unavailable, you set before us strong men of faith to take their place as uncles, brothers, grandfathers, deacons, pastors, and friends. Blessed is our Father in heaven, and blessed are the earthly fathers that remind us of his love, his mercy, and his grace. Amen.
Thank you.
Join me now in the prayer of confession, saying, Heavenly Father, you are our light. You guide us through our lives in joys and sorrows. You give us hope and guidance to share that hope with others. But too often, we are caught in shadows. We are afraid to reach out, reluctant to share your hope. Help us, Father, to be your light, to share your hope, to show your love and mercy to the world. Amen. And now, friends, let us offer our silent and personal confessions to the Lord. Brothers and sisters in Christ, there is good news. Because of the perfect love of Jesus, all of our sins are washed clean. The debt is paid. We are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Welcome, friends. Happy Father's Day. We are delighted that you are worshiping with us today. Please give the men around you a Father's Day greeting. To register your presence and let us know of your needs, please find the connection card and fill it out now so you can place it in the basket during the last hymn. If you are watching at home, you can find the connection card on our website. You may be seated now for the announcements and the message.
Did you know that 11% of Woodside's total budget goes to supporting missions? Because of your generosity, Woodside can reach out in Jesus' name to orphanages in Africa, house the homeless on winter nights with Code Blue, and build Habitat for Humanity houses right in our parking lot. Recurring giving is easy to set up and helps Woodside continue to support our many missions and ministries consistently, especially over the summer. You can set up recurring giving a variety of ways, with your bank using Bill Pay, through the website on the Give page, or through the Woodside app's Give tile. If you'd like help setting up a recurring gift, let us know on the connection card. For every new recurring gift set up, Woodside will donate $5 to the Morrisville Food Pantry. Consider setting up a recurring gift today. The lazy days of summer are great for rest and relaxation. They're also the perfect time to reconnect with God. This summer, escape to Woodside each Sunday, beginning June 26th. With our new message series, Summer Getaways. We'll head up to the mountains and down the shore with God's great saints in Scripture. Let the Lord use these weekly retreats to refresh and renew you. Want to learn more about discipleship? Looking to join a growth group? Join Meg Smith, Director of Discipleship, for coffee and donuts, Sunday, June 26th. Stop in before or after the morning services between 8:30 and 12:30 in room 101 near the sanctuary. Come chat with current growth group coaches and leaders about leading or joining a growth group. Also on June 26th is the return of KWAM, Woodside Sunday Morning Kids with a Mission program for preschoolers through fifth grade. It's offered at 9 a.m. and no registration is required. Woodside committed to supporting Urban Promise Trenton's camp the week of June 26th through 29th by providing healthy snacks for 70 campers each day of the week. You can find information about this and other ways to volunteer with one of Woodside's many food ministries, like Dinner Ministry or Coffee Hour, on the Woodside website under Serve. On Sunday, July 3rd, in honor of Independence Day, Woodside will offer one service at 10 a.m. outdoors, weather permitting. If weather doesn't permit, we'll move indoors to the vineyard. Either way, come ready to celebrate the Lord. Those are today's announcements. Be sure to check your email, the app, the website, and follow Woodside on social media to stay up to date with all that's happening here. If you filled out a paper connection card, drop that along with your offering envelope in the basket when it's passed during the final song. Now, let's continue worshiping God.
Good morning. I'm a little nervous this morning, but it reminds me of something that, looking out at all of you, reminds me of something the Reverend Bob Richards once said when he said, "The Lord must have loved ordinary people because he made so many of us." But then he said something very profound. He said, "Every single day and in every walk of life, ordinary people accomplish extraordinary things." Good morning, everyone. And for those of you who don't know me, my name is Gary LaSasso. For those of you who do know me, I know exactly what you're thinking. And I don't know why I'm up here either. I hope in the next few minutes we can figure that out together. I am truly honored and blessed to share my personal testimony with you today. I'm beyond humbled to be among so many ordinary people. This place, this family, this body of Christ has accomplished so many extraordinary things. Our daughter Ava's favorite verse is Jeremiah 29:11. She read it recently at my dad's funeral. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Another important passage to me comes from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 to 16, when Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." God's plan is to give us hope in these troubled times. God's plan is for us to sprinkle his salt and add flavor and seasoning to people's lives. God's plan is for us to bring his light to help people find their way in the darkness. On this day, I'd like to wish all fathers and stepfathers and grandfathers and father-in-laws and uncles and father figures a happy Father's Day. I am the proud father of Ava LaSasso. Hearing Ava sing and give praise to God for so many years in this building, on this stage, has always been very special and emotional for me. There is nothing she loves more than God, her family, and her friends. Being her dad is truly the most rewarding part of my life. I have learned so much about compassion and empathy from you, Ava. And I love you for that, and so many other reasons. I think we both learned compassion and empathy from your mom, my wife Dawn. She's the most beautiful woman in the world to me, both inside and out. And Dawn, my story and my testimony would not be worth telling if you were not in it. It's because you are my wife, and what I have become is because of you. For me, this is a bittersweet day, and emotional for another reason. This is the first Father's Day I will not be able to celebrate with my dad. Last October 6th, my father passed away due to complications from Parkinson's disease. My dad is my hero. I am proud of his life of service as a New Jersey State Trooper. I'm also blessed that my dad was present in my life and that he cared. He never missed one of my baseball games. He always told me growing up, have fun and do the best you can. And that not only applies on the field of sports, but it applies to life as well. My heavenly Father also gave me some great advice. In Jeremiah 29:11, which I read earlier, it says, God's plan is to give you hope. But when we use hope, we usually define it as a wish. I hope I'm going to get a promotion at work or a raise. Hope I'm going to get a good grade on a test. I hope that I get into a good college. I hope the doctor's appointment goes well and those test results come out okay. Oh, and my favorite one, I hope the Phillies' winning streak continues. It's giving us hope that they will win the World Series and make the playoffs. But God's hope is different. It's not a wish, or in the case of our Phillies making the playoffs a fantasy. God's hope is a guarantee. Hebrews 11 says, now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Biblical hope is a certainty. It's having confidence that God's plan is good. God's plan, for me, began to come together right here under this roof, in this room. I don't know how many people here have been a student or a parent of a student, a grandparent of a student, or teacher at Woodside Christian Preschool. Well, that's exactly where our family's faith journey picked back up in 2005. God started to sprinkle his salt and shine his light into our lives. And I can see today that this didn't happen by chance. It was part of God's plan. Ava was just 3 years old. In fact, she's sort of in the back with the blonde hair and the glasses. Now she's right here. and then here is a picture in 2001 of that same group last year when they graduated high school, in the same room, in the same positions. Back then, Ava met another Woodside mom, Jennifer Ullman. Jen the evangelist was probably Woodside's first sprinkle of salt from God's salt shaker in our lives. She simply invited Dawn and our family to attend a service at Woodside, with a little warning. It's not the same as the Catholic church that you guys grew up in. Our pastor, she said, plays in the band. Band? Well, that threw me for a loop. But okay, we'll give it a shot. Our first time, or one of the first times, was a vacation Bible school Sunday with songs and skits. And in one skit in particular, that guitar-playing pastor was sticking his arm in a toilet. Now, I'm not exactly sure what scripture passage mentions an arm in a toilet, but for us it worked. We were convinced that this was the place for us. Not only did we join Woodside, but for 5 years, I became a part of those very same VBS skits. I had so much fun with those skits, and I wasn't sure if the kids were really getting anything out of it, but I know I was. The second truly life-changing event at Woodside was participating in a growth group. Now, I want to try something that Doug tried way back when in this room. So if you're part of a growth group, please stand up. If you can't stand, just raise your hand. It's okay. If you were ever part of one, not now, that's okay. You could stand too. If you're part of the youth group, go ahead and stand. So that's a lot of people standing right now. If you're still sitting, I know how you feel, because my wife, who's right there, was standing next to me. I grabbed her arm and I said, sit down, sit down. But she looked down on me, literally and figuratively, and she said, I'm part of a growth group, you're not. So you can all go ahead and sit down. So that Doug's growth group recruiting tactic was going to lead me to be blessed with spiritual salt and inspiring light that continues to this very day. And eventually, we became salt and light for others. At the end of that service, I got out of this sanctuary as quickly as possible. I ran out the door. I told Dawn, I'll go get Ava from Sunday school. I was a bit embarrassed. Plus, I wanted to make sure Ava didn't get too many of those giant candy bars that our Sunday school teacher, Cliff Hutchins, used to hand out back in the day. As I quickly walked to the classrooms, I stopped by the sign-up lists for the growth groups, and one stuck out to me. I saw the names Dan Regan and Ken Parker. Dan, who I had met 10 years earlier, he and I were both young sales reps for a company in 1991. He was actually my boss, and I didn't even realize at the time that Dan went here. Ken lived in our neighborhood, so I thought, okay, at least I know some people. How bad could it be, right? I'll sign up for that group. And boy, I'm glad I did. Those guys inspired me to find a better version of myself. They drew me out of my comfort zone. In addition to Ken and Dan, there was John Hughes and Mike Gall. I met Bud Schofield, Cliff Hutchins, Bill Pelosi, Jeff McKenzie, Jeff Hill, Wade Jacobson. It was through these men and this growth group that I eventually was introduced to Habitat for Humanity, the Woodside Dinner Ministry, Code Blue, Urban Promise, the Recovery Ministry. We built structures in the tent city in Bristol for our homeless neighbors. The list goes on and on. All of these extraordinary service opportunities, a chance to shine God's light, made possible by the ordinary men and women here at Woodside. I also learned about mission trips. Each of these men at the time went on multiple mission trips. In fact, Ken Parker came up with this bright idea to bring the Woodside Senior High Youth Group to the Bahamas for a mission trip. But I drew the line there. Mission trips sounded cool, but it wasn't for me. Was way too far out of my comfort zone and not part of my plan. Well, of course, God had other plans for me. In time, Dan Shaw took over as the leader of the Bahamas mission trip, and in 2009, Ava and I were on a plane heading to the Bahamas. Watching kids who I have known for years come out of their comfort zone, holding God's light high, was inspirational and life-changing for me. Now, I know I'm going to leave out some of the kids from the group, but I remember my roommates, Ben and Brandon, coming out of their shells, and Jacob and Adam. They were on the roof, building a roof for a home. There was Jimmy Litley and Jack, and Jimmy actually brought some friends from his school. We had girls spackling and building a stucco wall. It was amazing. I saw Tyler, Carissa, Katie, all coming out of their comfort zone. Of course, there's a picture of Jeffrey there. You guys all know Jeffrey. He was perfectly in his comfort zone playing his guitar for our friends in the Bahamas, that's for sure. That was actually, due to COVID, the last trip that we were able to make to the Bahamas. Hopefully that changes soon, because it was very, very life-changing. Despite the hardships of COVID, our family life was going pretty well. Then things changed drastically for me in August of 2021. Shortly after we had dropped off Ava for her freshman year at Villanova, I was diagnosed with a very rare brain tumor called an acoustic neuroma. Part of me laughed at God's irony. I had spent 20 years working for rare disease companies, helping to improve the lives, in a small way, of patients and caregivers living with rare disease. Now I had one of my own. Frankly, it was quite a miracle that they even found the tumor. It turned out to be a very large tumor, but my only symptom was a slight hearing loss in my right ear. I was pretty shocked at the diagnosis, so much so I didn't even tell anyone, not even Dawn, for a couple of weeks. Keeping it to myself for that long and doing hours of research is frankly not a very good strategy to deal with something very scary. That fall, Dawn started as an assistant teacher here at Woodside Christian Preschool, the place where God's plan began to unfold for us 15 years ago. That was the same day I met with my neurosurgeon at Penn. He told me I needed surgery, I'd lose the hearing in my right ear, and there's a pretty good chance I would have facial paralysis. It was going to be only for a few months or a few years. He wasn't really sure. Everybody's different. That news was a little bit worse than I expected, quite a bit worse. At the end of that appointment, I sat on a bench near Independence Hall in Philadelphia, and I cried. I talked to God, you know, the typical why me stuff. I was feeling pretty depressed, and I was sitting there in my own world of darkness. And it was right then that a teacher had brought a group of school children out to play by the fountain there. The kids were about 4 years old, and the same age that Ava was when she started here, the same age of the kids that Dawn was teaching. It made me smile right then. It was a point in time it sort of changed things around a little bit. But it started a roller coaster, quite honestly. A roller coaster that continued. A couple of weeks after I learned that I would need this pretty major brain surgery, my father passed away. I was trying to keep positive, but it was pretty hard at the time. There was a lot to deal with. In some ways, I really didn't deal with it at all. I had a hard time focusing on anything. I was half grieving the loss of my dad. I was half grieving my own situation and preparing for surgery. I wasn't really doing either of the things all that well. Eventually, after a conversation with my cousin Frank, who had lost his dad less than a year earlier, my uncle, I started to do the things I needed to do to prepare myself. I had a second opinion with Dr. Michael Sisti in New York at Columbia Presbyterian, who he was eventually the surgeon that I used for my surgery. I had physical therapy to improve my balance before the surgery, more tests, more MRIs. From that point until my surgery on December 28th, I remained mostly positive, especially on the outside. The inside, not so much. There were some tough days. Although I didn't admit it to anyone until well after my surgery, I actually thought I was going to die. I prepared for it. I even wrote a letter to Dawn with specific details, including what readings and songs I wanted to be played at my funeral. I was in a pretty dark place. The darkest was on December 28th, 5:30 a.m., the morning of my surgery, when we walked into the hospital. Because of COVID restrictions, at one point, I had to go alone. I couldn't bring Ava or Dawn with me, and they had to stay out in the lobby. I hugged Ava and Dawn that morning, truly believing that that was my final I love you. But where there's darkness, there's light. Everything changed for me a couple of hours later. When I walked into that surgical suite that morning, I truly felt God's presence. It's hard to explain, really, but I felt a peace and a strength that I had never, ever felt before in my entire life. At that very moment, I was certain that I was going to be okay. I was certain of God's plan to prosper me and not to harm me. God gave me hope. About 12 hours later, I opened my eyes, and it was Dawn. Oh, my wife, Dawn, not the time of day. With Dawn running the show at home and Ava as her sidekick, my recovery went pretty smoothly. A few weeks of painkillers and steroids to reduce the swelling in my brain. How about that? They found a brain. A lot of physical therapy to improve my balance, and listening to my wife was just the treatment I needed to get back to normal. While I did lose the hearing completely in my right ear, everything else came out pretty good. I truly feel blessed to be here today. I will have some follow-up MRIs and to monitor the remaining tumor, but any other treatment will be pretty minor compared to what I had to go through back then. You know, for so long, I always thought you had to do really big things to make a difference in this world. But God gives us, ordinary people, opportunities to accomplish extraordinary things every single day. And these little things can make a profound difference in people's lives. For me, one of those moments came during recovery. It was on February 4th of this year. That was the day Laura Cullen was diagnosed with the same rare disease as me. I did not know Laura, but through a series of acquaintances, which would make your head spin, including a connection right here at Woodside, God connected me to this lady from Long Island. Soon, the salt and light which poured into our lives from here at Woodside would touch Laura's life as well. 2 days after she received the news from her doctor, I was on the phone with Laura sharing my acoustic neuroma journey. I told her about my surgeon. I opened up about my fears, including that irrational belief that I was going to die. I shared what got me through the dark days. My faith in Jesus, my wife, my daughter, the prayers from my family and my friends, and my trust in God's plan. I read Jeremiah 29:11 to her. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Dawn and I talked and texted and FaceTimed with Laura and her husband, Michael, a lot over the next month. Even the night before her surgery, we talked and we prayed with them. Later on Facebook, Laura said, it was very difficult to find positive information on this. I am beyond fortunate that I was led to my new best friends. In our first text, Gary wrote, I know that this time right after diagnosis is scary, but know this, you are going to be okay. That was it, the game changer for me. He changed everything for me with those few words. I went from fear to hope. On March 2nd, Laura had a successful 8-hour surgery to remove most of her acoustic neuroma. During her surgery, her husband, Michael, texted Dawn and I and said, I'm not sure how you two made it through this without you two in your lives. It was truly humbling to know that we made that much of a difference and that much of an impact on another person. It happened because God gave us that opportunity to be his salt and light. I don't think we did anything special. It was an emotional day for me, for sure. A couple of hours later, on the same day, I was back at Woodside for the first time since my surgery. It was the Ash Wednesday service, the soup service. I had the chance to tell Doug about my journey and about Laura. And that was when Pastor Doug invited me to give my testimony here today. God led an ordinary guy like me to do some extraordinary things with you, my Woodside family. God's plan brings hope, and I hope you can join God's plan. Thank you. Will you pray with me? Father, thank you. Thank you for my daughter Ava, who has brought so much joy to my life. I pray that you continue to bless others through her so that they see you through her life. I pray for my wife Dawn. She has been a shining example of love for both me and Ava, but also for anyone she meets. I pray for my father. I was blessed to have him on this earth for 56 years of my life. Please take care of him until I see him later. I pray for my family who have been there with me through the darkness and light. I pray for our Woodside family. There are so many points of light that come from this group of amazing people that shine your light in this world. And I pray all of this in the name of the one who brings us all hope, your Son and my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, hear our prayers. We come together today as your children, yearning for more hope and light in our broken world. On this Father's Day, we honor those men who are our fathers and those who have substituted in our lives as our fathers. We honor all the men who have taught, guided, and loved us during our lives. We ask that you bless them abundantly and continue to fill them with your light, that they may continue to give hope to the weary, help to the needy, and honor to the forgotten. In our community here at Woodside, we remember the fathers we have lost. We ask that they remain in our memory always. We pray for healing for those who are suffering from disease or injury. We lift up those who are devastated by addiction or mental illness. Open our eyes and ears to see and hear the needs of our neighbors, friends, and family members. Give us the courage and the strength of our fathers as we step out into our communities, our country, and our world to be your hands and feet, your salt and light. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand now as people with conviction to sing our final hymn,